Ladies and gentlemen of the experience, it's Jeremy Vaney, and I'm going to do something I rarely do, which is I'm going to cut out the preamble, because I have a feeling we're going to have a nice long chat this week with Buddy, let's put that in quotes, a.k.a. Alien Protocols, who you can find on YouTube by putting in Alien Protocols. He comes right up. He's got a YouTube channel. And he was actually recommended to me by a listener out there in listener land, and I'm very glad that he was, because checking out his YouTube channel, I got a good feeling about this one. So, Buddy, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it, and I appreciate your time and your listeners' time very much.
So I'm intrigued by you because a lot of what you talk about on YouTube seems to have a depth to it beyond the sort of materialist nuts and bolts UFO stuff that's out there. And yet you call yourself or your YouTube channel and your Twitter handle Alien Protocol. So I'm wondering what you mean by alien. I'm wondering what protocols are. And of course, I'm wondering what brings you to the microphone in the first place to want to speak to people about these subjects?
Wow, that's a lot of questions.
Sorry.
A lot of different stuff.
I'm a lazy interviewer. I just want to let you go and I'll just sit back and listen.
The efficiency I admire. Well, I guess a little bit of the background is I'm an experiencer. I had an experience when I was six, then another one at 12, 13. And an experience that next day, which really kind of set off the whole thing. And I got very involved and into it and hunted down a UFO researcher based on a book I saw on Roswell. And the researcher was well-known, Bill Moore. He was well-known years ago. And communicated with him for months. And then I just kind of found a place of comfort within my understanding. And there was many years from another experience. It was something very deep in my consciousness, and other aspects of phenomenology were very much in my consciousness since that time. And so when I got around, I guess like in my 20s, I did some more research, and I went and I did a documentary on a place called Mel's Hole in Washington State with a good buddy of mine, and done lots of research on, you know, ufology and stuff, but stayed behind the scenes, and also have been working on and improving during this kind of period my understanding of esoteric arts. Mostly, when you say that, sometimes people think, are you doing, you know, devil worship or something? And no, and it's not the super crystal age kind of stuff either. I really have a passion for the science behind our growing understanding of what I call psi, PSI, which, you know, others would call the world of ESP and all the associated powers of the mind. And so I've had a big, strong connection and fascination with that as well, going in parallel with the extraterrestrial stuff. And I've kept a low profile in terms of that stuff because of the social ramifications of talking about either of those issues can easily get you ostracized or, you know, people doubting your sanity and other things. So about 6 years ago, I bought this farm up in upstate New York in the Hudson Valley in a very deeply interesting area that has a huge history of weird phenomena and, you know, ghost houses. There's multiple ghost houses in this small little town, and a bunch of really weird things started happening at the farm, just kind of small, like orbs going through the woods and being like, oh, wow, that's weird. And multiple people seeing them and friends and family saying, hey, what's that? You know, and so we started to do CE5s and get some of the neighbors, local neighbors together, and we started working on our CE5 stuff. And CE5 is Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind. It's human-initiated ET contact. It's something that a lot of people credit to Stephen Greer, but it actually goes back really far. It goes back at least 2,000 years of going into deep meditation and seeing lights, so to speak. So we improved on these techniques and
After 2,000 years, you improved on the techniques? Wait a minute.
No. Oh. After our 6 years of working, you know, just during this process, getting better and better at everything. And slowly we found that the phenomena was getting lower and closer. And we've, you know, kind of played with what works and what doesn't work and studied other groups and kind of had really interesting experiences. So from there, we decided to kind of take it to the next level, which was wanting to bring science to bear on this stuff and these experiences.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And The Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to The Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
I have a very skeptical side of my brain. The left side of my brain is very hyper scientific and wants to see the evidence and wants to know the mechanics behind anything. And so in our quest to kind of facilitate both of those things, I started this project, and it's the Advanced Protocols Data Project. And it's to basically take these protocols that we learned and kind of added on top of the traditional CE5 meditation protocols with a couple other little things thrown in, and wanted to combine that with a scientific experiment whereby we have meditators there and we have cameras there and we have a series of scientific tests and equipment that can bring real hard data run by real scientists. I've spoken to so many of the top scientists, physicists and researchers in this field, and everyone from the head of research that MUFON had for a while named Chris Cogswell, who we started working with and getting some brilliant ideas from, to people like Dr. Jack Sarfati, who's very well known for his physics experiments and white papers on different types of warp drives. And he also was an experiencer and had a wild experience where when he was young, he basically picked up a phone and spoke to an intelligence on board a craft that told him he was going to be one of 400 people to be doing this research that he ended up doing. And so to make a long story short, we came up with these advanced protocols. We have been having success, and we've broached now into the scientific side of it. And then I decided to launch the channel use the power of the crowdsourcing to kind of give us more ideas and give us more power of meditation power, because we strongly believe in the collective power of consciousness and the ability to affect reality. So many studies have been done from, you know, the Maharishi effect that has been, I mean, tons of studies. There's a couple of videos I have on our site about the nature of those studies and the stunning results that they've proved. We wanted to utilize that ability to get a bunch of CE5 groups around the world and connect with them, and use this crowdsourcing to connect with more CE5 groups around the world and kind of unify and help each other and uplift each other. And in that process, we've had just amazing things happen. And anyway, now a year after basically we started the channel, well, not even quite a year yet, we have hundreds of CE5 groups together in a network. And when we help them and they help us and back and forth, and when we start our big main experiments, we're going to have literally hundreds of CE5 groups around the world concentrating on our experiment location, which is something that's never been done before. And even if no like phenomenology happens in terms of like, you know, the craft or anything like that, we can still garner hard scientific data on whether the power of consciousness is real or not, considering the extraordinary circumstance we're trying to build. So we would not only have a top kind of meditation group on site, but also have all these meditators around the world thinking about that location and focusing positively on that location. And we would have experiments, everything running from, you know, number generators to calorimeters to see if entropy is decreased or increased in that area, or if luck is increased or decreased. So it kind of satisfies both sides of my brain, that scientific side and that esoteric side. So hopefully I was able to answer your question in there and explain what we are and the protocols and what we're doing. And the word alien I hate. You know, I don't like the word alien in terms of the connotation, you know. It has a lot of negative connotations
to
it.
Well, wait a second. So, but in terms of that, do you believe that on the other end of your meditative telephone line, if it works, there's another being from another planet in this universe who is listening in and hopefully responding?
Unquestionably. Unquestionably.
Okay. Well, and that would be what we would consider an alien, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. And you have a healthy understanding and aren't too polarized by the term, but a lot of people are, and I understand their feeling on that. For me, I don't take it as that context. I take it as something foreign, you know, something different. And in that way, you know.
Okay. Boy, where to begin here? Well, let me begin just sticking with the alien thing, because a lot of what we talk about when not talking alien is trickster theory, or is interdimensional, or, you know, something closer to home, something interrelated with us.
Yeah. Well, you know what? There is something real in the universe, the trickster theory, the whole trickster aspect of the universe. The universe has a mercurial hermetic nature. You know, Hermes and Mercury both were the messengers, and they also had a little sense of humor too. So when they delivered the messages for the gods, sometimes they would play a little bit with the messages and have a little bit of fun. And, you know, I think we all learn from our lives that the universe isn't completely A to B to C. Sometimes the universe will surprise you and put in something you don't expect that goes beyond statistical chance. That's too weird or bizarre to be normal. And I think when those things happen repeatedly, you start to get an understanding of the nature of reality. And the nature of reality isn't necessarily completely what we think it is. There's definitely a Murphy's Law. There's definitely a sense of humor about the universe. And when you kind of accept that and understand it and embrace it, I think you can access some of that stuff more.
Then how would you be able to tell the difference? Well, how would you be able to tell, period, that it's a person from another planet on that you're communicating with?
I think you get different evidences. You know, like for us, I have videos of solid craft. I mean, it's, you know, when you have dancing lights and things, you can say, oh, it could be a natural phenomenon. It could be some geophysical earth lights or, you know, some sort of plasma phenomena we're not, you know, familiar with yet. But when you see a craft, you know, 200 feet up in the air, your mind is completely certain that it is. Now, of course, there's always, you know, conjectures about, well, what if the nature of your consciousness is affected by something else and you're seeing what you want to see or all these other things. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm very much grounded in terms of that stuff, having an understanding that sometimes it's not only seeing is believing, sometimes believing is seeing. You know, so I understand the nature of those things. And when what I've seen numerous times just leaves me without any shadow of a doubt, just in terms of my vision, just what I've physically seen, aside from all my other senses and experiences I've had. And I think most people who listen to your show, if they really do the research, they should come to the logical conclusion that we are being visited. And that's just a rational scientific approach based on the best evidence cases. I think it's very hard to deny the possibility that we're not just the possibility, the reality that we're being visited big time.
Well, let me stop you there and ask you this.
We'll be back after this. Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant. But then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Welcome back.
You're saying scientific, rational. Do you believe that there's anything that transcends and includes science and rationality to this phenomenon?
That transcends and includes? I think it all, it includes it, but in some way it transcends it. When you're dealing with anything that's kind of an edge science, it's going to transcend your understanding. And anything that you're trying to learn what it is, in some aspect, it's always going to transcend your understanding. And in fact, that's healthy. To have to know that something's a little bit beyond my understanding, that can actually allow you to learn more. There's a great master sushi chef that I met who he was an unagi chef, and basically he was 90 years old, and they interviewed him and they said, you know, you've been doing this for 75 years. You know, they say that you're the best in the world. You know, how did you get so good? And he's like, oh, no, I'm not a master. I'm not that good. I'm just learning. And, you know, in that kind of attitude, allows you to transcend, go further, you know,
right,
without setting limitation.
Well, to sort of evolve. But do you think that there is anything about the human being that by transcendent include, meaning you would have to get there through a sort of transformation that is instantaneous, not through a process of learning? That would be something, a mutation almost, as opposed to an evolution. Do you think that there is something in us like that, or no? Can everything be learned too?
I think it's a combination of both. You know, for me, I like to think you can science the heck out of anything, even spiritual things. You know, for example, ESP is something that has been, you know, as astonishing as it is to hear, if you haven't done the research, it's been proven, basically. ESP and the powers of the mind, as far as I'm concerned, when you look at everything from Stanford research, Stanford's research institute's work with remote viewing for 20 years with the Defense Department and the CIA, to the many studies that have been done on everything from the Maharishi effect to psychokinesis. These abilities of the mind to affect matter and the universe around us non-locally, as far as I'm concerned, based on the tons of research I've done, is unequivocal. I mean, it's there's no doubt in my mind that the mind affects reality. And when you look at physics, you know, that's not something that has to transcend the laws of science. You know, when you look at physics, the ultimate particles, the subatomic elementary particles, they have a tendency not to be black or white. They have a tendency to be defined by you interacting with them and observing them. People so oftentimes think, you know, is material the ultimate constituency of existence? Is it matter or is it consciousness? And some people say, well, you can't have consciousness without matter and you can't have matter without consciousness. And I'm one of those who believe that they're deeply interwoven and you can't separate them. You really cannot separate them. Because of that intimate tapestry of matter and consciousness, that there's so many options available to us that we're just not really aware of in our modern society. We haven't given ourselves the okay to explore these areas without ridicule, and accept the fact that they're real. Now, they may not work as directly and powerfully as, you know, my physical ability to pick up a knife and, you know, throw it or, you know, whatever. But the ability to touch beyond, to interact non-locally with matter and space and time is real. And you have to accept first that consciousness and matter are kind of intertwined in order to get there, in my belief system. Some people who believe consciousness is fundamental can get there too. You know, they can say, well, consciousness is the absolute most fundamental thing, and because of that, I can connect to anything. And that works, you know. And ultimately, too, you know, in all of this, these are just my thoughts. And right, these are my thoughts now based on my learning. And, you know, I'm learning and growing every day, I hope to be.
Yeah.
And they may metamorphosize and grow over time, but that's really strongly how I feel.
Okay. So the observer effect from is it the double slit experiment? I watched your video on that today,
yeah,
actually. And so the observer effect, now, are particles and particle wave duality an occurrence that happens in response to pure observation or to the expectation of the observer?
Well, I think it's based on, it's almost as if a computer program is running and says, hey, someone's watching, you have to make a decision, universe. And that's kind of what happens. And that way, consciousness affects matter. I'm one of those who believe, you know, if no one's there, you don't hear the tree fall in the woods, and the tree's not doesn't even exist, and the woods don't even exist. And I believe, you know, physics gives us a lot of real science to kind of back up that notion. So it's a weird place to be at, because if you accept the powers of the mind, if you accept that your mind can affect matter, if you accept the fact that your mind can even affect matter unintentionally, then you have to take responsibility for your thoughts at a much deeper, more profound level. You know, it's not like The Secret where they say, you know, if you believe something, it becomes a reality. It's much deeper than that. If you believe something, you change physically reality. They did some tests that were really, really cool. One of them was done, I forget the group's name who did it, but it was several scientists, and it was about unintentional psychokinesis. And they were, psychokinesis is telekinesis for those who are unfamiliar with that term. And they did something extraordinary. They did a lot of psychokinesis experiments with random number generators, saying, okay, concentrate on this machine and see if you can make the numbers go more positive than negative. And consistently, humans are able to prove that they can do that. But they did something really clever. They did that with a martial arts class of students. And they said, okay, make this random number generator go positive, more positive than negative. And they did that. But what they didn't know, the students didn't know, is that the random number generator actually picked those numbers 2 days previously. So the conclusion they came to, and there's possible other conclusions, but the conclusion they came to was reverse retrocausality psychokinesis, that they were able to affect the random number generator retrocausally, meaning backwards in time. And that's not a far out notion completely in terms of science. A lot of scientists believe the reason why entanglement works is because once you affect one particle, no matter the distance, that particle sends a message backwards in time to when the two particles were together. And then it goes forward in time to the other particle. And because it's a temporal issue to those at the end time period, it appears to be instant. But if you were traveling at the speed of light, like the particle is, backwards in time and then forwards in time the other direction, it's instant. So in a lot of weird ways, causality and time and space, it's not what we think it is. I mean, it is for the most part, but it's more dynamic than we've ever given it credit for.
Let me ask you a question, because I'm the interviewer. I just realized I just said, let me ask you a question. So why do you suppose it is that physicists, I know in ufology, of course, they're willing to do these experiments and all that, but scientists and physicists at large are unwilling to say that something like the double slit experiment scales up, so that we can, in fact, control reality or even do the type of meditative extending ourselves into the universe that you're talking about? Why do you think they don't want to say that it scales up if it does?
Well, I think it scales up at a very low percentile. You know, they have physics students oftentimes try to predict the chance that I'm able to disappear from this sofa and reappear on Mars. And there's actually a statistical way to find out. You calculate all the different particles within a human body and you know all the different chances and da-da-da-da-da. And they make conjectures as to what is the chance. And of course, as you scale up larger and larger from the subatomic level, that chance diminishes. But there still is a chance. Even if the chance is longer than the expected life of the universe, there's still a chance. And even the biggest physicists, if they, you know, will tell you that is the case. So it does scale up. It just doesn't scale up numerically in the way that we normally think, you know, or we normally expect it would, you know. We would like it to scale up just as quickly as it does at the subatomic level, because then you could make stuff appear and disappear all around you. But that would be a very chaotic universe to live in if, you know, it's a little bit more stable at this size level. So
if you didn't have the experience that you had at a young age, do you think that you would be focusing on this stuff? Do you think that you would be the person who says these things about something else, even?
No. I don't know. You know, it's hard to say. It's had such a fundamental impact on who I am, you know, and it's really, I couldn't imagine being anyone else. And it sounds strange, but I couldn't imagine, a passion in another place that I think is more important. You know, I think this is such an important kind of understanding for humanity to grasp how powerful our minds are to affect reality around us. And it's also about a little bit about belief. It's about hope. It's about positivity. It's about your ability to affect positive change around you. And that's powerful stuff, I think, you know, and I'm just thankful to be here and be in these shoes and all that stuff. You know, my life has been a poetic life of ups and downs, but even the downs define, you know, who I am. So I probably wouldn't change a thing.
So the original experience that you had, you're saying this was a UFO sighting, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
Do you think that it was there for you to see, or do you think you just happened upon it?
I think it was a plan. It was a script. It was something scripted. The whole thing was something scripted. I think that I oftentimes get the feeling that I'm living out a script and that this is a script that's been pre-written.
So what do you think the ending is? I mean, if you're because, you know, clearly these beings then could just land and say hi or impart the knowledge necessary to do the correct protocols to, you wouldn't have to do all of these experiments if they would just open their mouths, right? Why do you think they don't do that?
They are communicating with us and they're, building a relationship and they're slowly pacifying our fears because this is a whole reality shift. The reality that we are not the center of the universe. You know, we're still very much like times were with Galileo and Copernicus, where, you know, the society and, of course, the churches and all that think, you know, humanity is the center of the universe. And they used to think the earth was the center of the universe. And they had great difficulty convincing the world that, no, we actually revolve around a sun. The universe doesn't revolve around us. But now, hundreds of years later, we're still in the same position where humanity and science and most of the population thinks the universe revolves around us. And it's really not the case. It's a much bigger universe. Our family is a lot bigger than just the other creatures that are on this planet. The same things happen on lots of planets out there. There's billions and billions and billions and billions of planets. To think that we're the only ones is just the height of ignorance and almost, foolishness.
Well, let me. Here's a question I've never asked anybody. So you just mentioned animals and you know, all of our friends around the world here. If a fox came up to you and in its own fox language, and you could kind of understand what it was doing, invited you to its family and then sort of disappeared, would you spend your entire life trying to chase that fox and trying to convince people who think animals are just stupid animals that had happened? Or do you think that that type of obsessiveness can only happen in connection with a quote-unquote alien or other off-planet?
Well, I think psychology is with different people can motivate them to do almost anything. You can almost find any justification within the human mind. But in terms of that analogy, it would be as if no one had ever really seen foxes before. You use an analogy where everyone's used to an animal, you know, and this is different. This is something from outside our understanding, really, outside our realm. This is new. This is at the edge of our understanding. And because of that, I think it's very understandable that someone would be like, look, I just saw something on the edge of our understanding. You need to know that this is happening. And that's how knowledge grows. You know, if that happens with anything, you know, that people aren't aware of. Look, there's a lake with fresh water, you know, 7 miles away. Our tribe and our village can have fresh water if we just go this direction. You know, there's solid information out there that we can take and grab and use the knowledge of for you know, good or bad or whatever. But the reality is we just as dynamic as our rainforest is and that there's all sorts of mysterious different animals there. Our universe is the same way. And just because an animal might be really strong doesn't necessarily mean that it's a threat. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's evil. It's just different. And I think the visitors, time and time again, have proven that they're not evil and they're not a threat and they're not, you know, horrific. In fact, they could be doing something incredibly, incredibly important.
Okay, so do you think that they're trying to grow you in a way, or do you think that it is all scripted? Because as you're talking, I realize we're using the term alien. You can use the term visitor, and these conjure the image of, you know, the typical either Whitley Strieber communion cover or the gray, or, you know, we know. So in other words, much like the fox, we already do have an image of what it means to say alien or visitor.
And that image might be wildly wrong.
It might be wildly wrong, of course. No matter what the image is, it's there. We know that we're talking about something similar, whether we believe that it is good or evil or indifferent, whatever feeling we ascribe to it. We all know basically at least the visual of what we're talking about and some of the characteristics of the psychic ability, and they stare at you and this sort of thing. So given that, at what point are we ready for open contact or for even your protocols to work?
It's a big meal. It is a big meal, and you don't eat this meal all in one mouthful, one chunk. You can't. It's too much. You have to have kind of a spoonful at a time to get understanding.
Non-subscribers, that jingle means our time is up, and if you would like to continue spoon-feeding understanding down your gullets, that doesn't sound pleasant, but if you would, click that subscribe tab, get the rest of this episode, get all of the experience in all of Dreamland in their entirety commercial free. Go ahead, do it, because half a show is just half a show, but a whole show, now that's a meal. My thanks again to Buddy, Alien Protocols. Look him up. Look up the organization. Is it really an organization, or is that sort of loosely an organization? I guess they're organized, so it's an organization. Alien Protocols, don't mind my babble. Just look them up on YouTube and on Twitter. If you like what you're hearing here, get involved with them. Either way, I will see you next week right here in the experience. Take care.